Good evening and welcome to CMI's President's Awards 2020. Whether you're a member, student, partner or practitioner, we're delighted you joined us for our first ever blended awards ceremony, taking place live, both online and from our studio in London. Tonight is an opportunity to celebrate the exceptional example set by managers and leaders across the world during the challenges of the past few months. You'll hear from inspirational leaders at the forefront of their industries, as well as from CMI, about what we, as the Chartered Professional Body for Managers, are doing to create better-led and managed organisations. We already have an impressive number of people getting involved and sharing their thoughts with us via social media from all over the world. Don't forget, you can join in on the conversation tonight using the hashtag CMI President's Awards. In the meantime, let us tell you a little more about the work of CMI. Tonight, we'll be celebrating a range of CMI's highest accolades, including the Gold Medal and Lifetime Achievement Awards. We'll also hear from CMI's Royal Patron, Her Royal Highness the Countess of Wessex, and our incoming President, Lord Mark Price. But first, I'm delighted to introduce CMI's Chief Executive, Anne Frenker, OBE, to begin tonight's proceedings, and CMI's outgoing president, Bruce Carnegie Brown, to deliver the presidential address. Esteemed guests, please welcome Anne Frenker.
Welcome to CMI's 2020 President's Awards. As our opening video reminds us, it's been a year of constant change and doing things differently. Personally, I am so proud of how the CMI community has responded to the COVID crisis and of our newly received Platinum IIP Award. In this tumultuous year, it's no great surprise that we've had to radically adapt our annual award ceremony. As managers and leaders, whether joining me in the studio or watching live, we are all aware of the unprecedented challenges that organizations and individuals have faced across the world since the start of the year. Colleagues have looked to us for support and guidance in an uncertain and frankly scary world. They've turned to us for answers, changing course, taking brave new decisions, and adopting new plans in hours and or even days in an ever-changing environment. And in every corner of the globe, we've reminded them of the difference that great managers and leaders make and the humanity, kindness, and dedication of our profession. So tonight is a celebration. Tonight we're celebrating the generosity of time and spirit that managers and leaders in all sectors have shown. Whether in the public sector, like the NHS and police, delivering essential services, in our education institutions, ensuring the next generation doesn't lose their footing, or in the third sector, acting as lifelines in local communities. And the many business leaders who have stepped up to help their staff, their customers, and communities to cope in these trying times. You are all heroes. Tonight, we're especially celebrating our CMI community, which remained active and positive in very difficult circumstances. Our members, our companions, our volunteers, future leaders, chartered managers, and our wonderful colleagues, learners, and education partners. Across the board, I have been so inspired by how every member of our CMI community has gone above and beyond to support our mission and vision, knowing that we need it now more than ever. And of course, tonight we're celebrating our special award winners. Each selected from an extremely competitive shortlist, they are individuals and organizations who've demonstrated inspirational leadership through their innovation, empathy, and drive to raise themselves and those around them. Tonight is for you. Now, in the past, I would be opening the President's Awards from a hallowed hall amidst fine food and wine and the buzz of black tie conversations. But as with so much this year, circumstances have forced us to change the way we've always done things. And a lot of times, it has been for the better. I am so excited to broaden this event so that more of our members and friends can take part and celebrate with us. And I welcome the over 1,800 of you who've signed up and hope you donned your black tie and sparkly tops and paired them with your baggy pajama bottoms that we simply won't see. In particular, I'm excited to welcome our international audiences tonight, and forgive me if this is more of a breakfast or nightcap celebration where you are. If we carry one thing forward with us into 2021, I hope it's that our joint humanity, that we have faced this threat together through collaboration, and that there we have been our strongest. However, for now, it's time to let the celebrations begin. We have many exemplary leaders to recognize, including our award winners, the Chartered Manager of the Year, Learner of the Year, Partner of the Year, and many others. We will both honor and hear from our Gold Medal winner and Lifetime Achievement Award winners, as well as from our wonderful patron, Her Royal Highness, the Countess of Wessex, and our inspiring new CMI President, Lord Mark Price. But first, I am equal parts delighted and sad to welcome CMI's incredible past president and my friend to deliver his final presidential address. Ladies and gentlemen, Bruce Carnegie Brown.
Thank you, Anne. I'd like also to add my thanks to yours, to our patron, Her Royal Highness, the Countess of Wessex. It's very good to have you here with us this evening, and we very much appreciate your active support for everything we are doing at CMI. Thank you also to everyone for participating in this President's Award evening online. I hope you have a good evening. As Anne has said, this evening is my last chance as your president to reflect not just on the last year of CMI's activities, but also on the last 3 years in terms of how the Institute has developed. What is most striking for me is the breadth of our undertakings and our increasing reach into an ever-broadening range of activities relative to where we were just 3 years ago. We continue to focus on growing our membership at a time when many membership organizations are seeing membership decline. We continue to expand our partnerships in the educational sector. 3 years ago, we had just 590 educational partners. Today, we have 822, an increase of some 40%. We continue to expand the range of our qualifications and to support individuals at all stages of their lives, from university students and apprentices to senior managers and leaders. 3 years ago, we had 38,000 learners enrolled in our programs. Today, we have over 90,000. Today, there are 31,000 learners on our apprentice programs, up from a few hundred 3 years ago. And we now have 10,500 chartered managers, up some 80% on the 5,800 we had 3 years ago. We've invested more in thought leadership and in providing insights to our managers and leaders in all sectors of the UK economy, and not just in the UK. Today, we have increasing engagement internationally, with almost 50% of the viewers of our digital events being based outside the United Kingdom. And most recently, after a 12-month pilot in partnership with the Management Consultancies Association, we've launched our new award for those working in the management consulting industry to recognize the high quality of professionalism in that sector. To date, over 1,000 learners have enrolled and some 150 awards have been made. All of this has been underpinned both by an investment in our technology platform to make it easier for our learners and partners to engage with CMI, and by strong financial performance. Over the last 3 years, to the end of March 2020, CMI's revenues had grown by 37%. And I'm also delighted to say that this strong performance continues through the pandemic period. CMI moved to remote working seamlessly in March and has been delivering all of its programs virtually since then. During that time, engagement has increased significantly. On average, our digital events see 278 viewers tuning in to watch live. And this increases to over 3,600 views per event within the first month of being made available online. Having this strong voice is vital to CMI's role of offering guidance and support to managers and organizations navigating through uncharted waters in which we're all operating. I'm also pleased to be able to share some early interim findings of CMI's industry-leading Management Transformed research, which we expect to launch in the first week of November. Human skills are proving vital to managing through change and uncertainty. With many organizations moving to virtual and blended working, a manager's role in connecting with their teams will be of critical importance. And for those in workplaces where demand has reduced because of COVID-19, managers will need strong communication skills to manage well. We're also discovering that managers working virtually or in a mixed environment of virtual and physical are likely to miss their workplace-based networks and the workplace setting more than non-managers. The impact of the pandemic looks set to be with us for many months to come. Its impact on many sectors of the economy is devastating, and it is taking its toll on the well-being of many employees across the country. And I'm afraid the worst is yet to come. Government intervention has been swift and substantial across the economy, and the furlough scheme has thrown a lifeline to employers and employees. But these measures were and are intended to be a bridge to economic recovery. And that recovery looks more distant and more difficult. So the reckoning is yet to come. And we have to anticipate that many of those furloughed will not transition back into the workplace, but will become unemployed. They will need to seek new opportunities and will need access to training and reskilling in order to compete successfully for those new opportunities. In the management of its own affairs, CMI has been able to return all furloughed employees to full employment with the Institute, and the services we offer have never been more in demand from universities, from employers, from managers, and from our members. As a place to work, I'm delighted to say CMI has improved the recognition it has received, as Anne mentioned, in the Investors in People Platinum Award, an increase from gold last year. All of this is due to the hard work of CMI's brilliant staff, who've shown great commitment and dedication throughout these challenging times. And I'd like to thank them and Anne and her senior team, whose talent and leadership have made my role at CMI so easy. And finally, I'd like to welcome Lord Mark Price as CMI's new president. I'm thrilled that he's agreed to take on the role, and we will hear from him a little later on. And now it gives me great pleasure to begin our award ceremony with a video. And for the avoidance of doubt, this was filmed pre the pandemic and pre the advent of social distancing.
We've already had some great interactions coming in from social media. Don't forget to join the conversation using the hashtag CMI Presidents Awards. CMI sets the standard for managers and leaders, and that means we have the pleasure of recognising and celebrating excellence. Our awards span the breadth and depth of management and leadership today, from the students and apprentices just starting out in their careers to the chartered managers who have reached the pinnacle, from the providers and higher education institutions training the next generation of leaders to the companies innovating to best support their managers, and our volunteers across the board who make our community so vibrant. Distinguished guests, please join us in celebrating our award winners. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2020 CMI President's Awards. We are proud and excited to present to you the very best of the management and leadership profession, chosen from a record-breaking number of high-quality award entries. Our nominees are helping to develop next-generation best practice and are the embodiment of CMI's vision to create better-led and managed organizations. So, on behalf of CMI, a huge congratulations to all of our 2020 winners and nominees. CMI Volunteer of the Year 2020. Tonight, we recognize Denise Skinner as our Volunteer of the Year for 2020. Not only has Denise led the East Midlands Regional Board in the UK with distinction, but she has also led from the front in redefining the shape, structure, and purpose of our regional boards. A huge congratulations to you, Denise. CMI Management Book of the Year Award 2020. Over many years, CMI, in conjunction with our partners at the British Library and Henley Business School, have awarded the prestigious Management Book of the Year. It's with huge pride that we congratulate Matthew Syed, author of this year's Management Book of the Year, Rebel Ideas.
I just want to say a huge thank you for voting me Management Book of the Year for Rebel Ideas, which is about diversity of thought and how when you bring different people together, you get this uplift in collective intelligence. I'm very grateful to the CMI for honouring me with this award.
CMI Student of the Year 2020. Preparing the next generation of managers and leaders is at the core of what we do at CMI. Our student community is at record levels thanks to the work of our partner universities, colleges, training providers and employees. Our winner, Aniba Khalid, recently graduated and was one of 90,000 students working towards a CMI qualification over the last year. The judges congratulate Aniba on demonstrating a hugely positive impact on her own professional development and academic studies through effective application of the theory she's learned at Leicester University Business School. Fantastic work, Aniba, and we look forward to hearing what's next for you. CMI Apprentice of the Year 2020. Many of you across the CMI community know just how important apprentices are to the development of management talent in all areas of the UK economy and the crucial role they play in embedding greater social mobility. Employees have embraced these apprenticeships, and we now have record numbers of management apprentices in England. 30,000 of them part of the CMI family, up from just a few hundred 4 years ago. And so again, competition to become Apprentice of the Year was incredibly tough. This year, we recognise Anthony Collins of Veolia as CMI Apprentice of the Year. Anthony, our heartfelt congratulations on your incredible win tonight. CMI Learning Provider of the Year. Our ever-growing global network of partners delivering CMI programmes and qualifications is a cornerstone of how we go about approaching our mission of increasing the number and standard of professionally qualified managers and leaders. Although it's incredibly tough to select just one winner, we are delighted to announce that the 2020 CMI Learning Provider of the Year is Cornell, who continue to innovate and deliver incredible apprenticeship programs for its many high-profile clients and thousands of learners. Many congratulations go to Sean Williams, CEO and co-founder of Cornell, and all of his team on a truly outstanding year in developing thousands of conscious leaders for the benefit of our economy and society. CMI Higher Education Partner of the Year. This award recognises outstanding impact in the field of higher education. What made tonight's winner stand out to our judges was the combination of an exemplary business management course being applied to an industry which you wouldn't traditionally link to management education. Our winner understands that businesses in the fashion industry are no different to businesses in any other industry. They succeed and flourish on the skills of their people. This year's HE Partner of the Year is equipping its learners with the skills that the fashion industry will need for years to come. Many congratulations to tonight's winner, the Manchester Fashion Institute at Manchester Metropolitan University. CMI Outstanding Innovation and Delivery Award 2020. The best management and leadership should not be confined to the classroom, and our outstanding delivery partners put this into practice every day. Nowhere in this mindset more obvious than in tonight's winner of the Outstanding Innovation and Delivery of the Year Award. Travis Perkins. The remarkable innovation in the design and delivery of their management and leadership programs, alongside the demonstrable impact of learner outcomes, allow Travis Perkins to stand out in a competitive category.
We're really pleased to win the award, and to be honest, the timing's been great for us because, you know, the reality is that we started looking at how we innovate our programs a year or so ago. We started looking at how we use video and bringing more digital solutions in rather than pen and paper. And it's been brilliant for us now that we've had to look at COVID and we've had to move face-to-face delivery out of our programme because we're already well into that journey.
CMI Chartered Manager of the Year. Chosen from over 90 entries, we are delighted to recognise Manisha Mistry, Head of Digital Culture at Rolls-Royce, as this year's Chartered Manager of the Year. Manisha was chosen as this year's winner as her story is an inspiring example to so many other managers and leaders.
I still remember the phone call from CMI when they were letting me know that I'd won. And I think I might have surprised them because it didn't sink in, I think is the words. Just wasn't something I'd expected. So a real, real moment for me and one that I won't forget, being told that I'd been an award winner.
If you've been inspired tonight, I'm delighted to announce that the nominations for CMI's 2021 awards are now open. On behalf of CMI, we want to say a huge thank you to all of our judges, our nominees and our winners, and everyone involved in delivering tonight's awards. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to hand back to our host and your president, Bruce Carnegie Brown.
Her Royal Highness,
now that you've had a chance to hear and learn from this year's winners, you'll be delighted to know nominations for next year's awards are now open. Check out the criteria for the 2020 awards and learn more by scanning the QR code on your screen.
It's now my privilege to invite our patron, Her Royal Highness, the Countess of Wessex, to address us. Your Royal Highness.
My heartfelt congratulations to this year's award winners. I'm so sorry that we're not all able to be together, but I hope that you're feeling the virtual love that we are doing our best to send you all. I'm delighted, however, to be joined by three of our awardees in the studio, and that we have been able to recognise each and every special winner and recognise your achievements, regardless of the current pandemic and the restrictions on coming together. I'm so pleased that the CMI, in spite of COVID, did indeed continue with their plans to award and celebrate excellence and good example by holding this event, so that we may be able to pay tribute and congratulate individuals both experienced in their careers and just starting out. We need positivity and good news stories all the more in this strange new world, and I hope that everyone will leave this evening both inspired and uplifted. It's impossible to cover everything our award winners have achieved in one speech. However, I would just like to single out a couple of examples that struck a chord with me. Since the start of the COVID crisis, society has relied heavily on volunteers to shore up and maintain the needs of so many. Because of where my work takes me, I'm in the privileged position of meeting many volunteers who every week are performing vital roles within our communities. Volunteers often go unsung and unnoticed, yet without them, we would be lost. There is nothing like a crisis to bring out the best in people, and I have been warmed by the many who have stepped up to support their local hospitals, food banks and charities, giving so much of their time and energy. My hope is that when we do manage to get back to a more normal way of life, that those who have experienced the benefits and joy of volunteering find a way of continuing with their support, and that companies do more to give their employees the opportunity to do so in whatever way that may be, as we have seen in the case of Denise Skinner. Young people are being much affected by the current situation, whether they are trying to get on with their studies, which have been disrupted over the past months, seeking employment, or just starting out in a new job where they're not even able to meet their new colleagues. I'm delighted that we've been able to recognize some young talent in the form of Aniba, and we wish you well as you begin your career. And of course, as we see some industries really struggling to survive through the pandemic, there will be need for people to retrain and seek alternative job opportunities. Never before has the apprenticeship scheme been so important, and I'm delighted that we have Anthony Collins, who has shown us all what his apprenticeship has done for him. You say you still have a way to go, Anthony. I have no doubt that you will get there. It would be remiss of me not to mention the digital world and its importance in all our lives. How many of us here tonight wish that we had invested in Zoom, I wonder? Technology has been even more critical to the success of the business world, but as our habits and styles of working change, has our ability to lead. It is therefore imperative that we keep pace with the ever-expanding, digitally literate world. I have no doubt that the CMI will be ensuring that its members have every opportunity to ensure that you are equipped for this new way of working and styles of managing. Finally, I'd also like to add my own personal thanks to Bruce Carnegie Brown for his fabulous stewardship as president of the CMI, and to welcome Lord Price, who now takes up the presidential reins. Bruce leaves some impressive shoes to fill, but I know, Mark, you are more than up to the task, and may I say how delighted I am to be working with you once again. Also, I promise not to hold you to account as to the ripeness of the fruit at your stores, as I may have done so in the past. To all of the awardees, enormous congratulations. I hope you're extremely proud of yourselves and that this recognition will inspire you towards even greater achievements in the future. Thank you very much, Bruce.
Your Royal Highness, thank you very much indeed, and thank you for everything that you do for CMI.
Thank you.
It now comes a time to hear from our gold medal winner for 2019. The medal was awarded to David Roberts, CBE, Chairman of the Nationwide Building Society. David has over 30 years of senior leadership roles at board and executive level in retail banking in the United Kingdom and internationally. David started his career at Barclays Bank and during his 23 years became known for his ability to manage large-scale complex projects, his capacity to drive real and sustainable culture change, and his focus on the customer. He held a wide range of senior management positions, including Chief Executive International Retail and Commercial Banking, CEO Private Clients International, CEO Personal Financial Services, and CEO Business Banking, charged with all of Barclays' SME business across Europe and the UK. Today, David has a number of professional roles. In addition to his chairmanship of the Nationwide Building Society, he is the Deputy Chairman of NHS England, and a non-executive chairman of Beazley PLC. David was awarded his CBE in 2009 in the Queen's Birthday Honours List for services to financial services and to the NHS. David.
Thank you, Bruce. I have to say that when I got a phone call from Anne saying that I'd been awarded this incredible honour, I have to say I was completely silent, which for me, as people who know me, is very unusual. Your Royal Highness, ladies and gentlemen, to colleagues listening and watching around the world, it is an enormous privilege to be here and to follow in the shoes of some remarkable leaders. Who would have thought the lad from the grammar school in Liverpool would be standing here today? It's a great honour. I was asked to talk on my reflections on my leadership journey, and in my 37 years I've learned an awful lot from many, many good leaders, and also from a few not so good leaders, and of course we learn from everyone. And I've had the privilege of working in different models of private companies, public companies such as Lloyd's and Barclays, now Beazley, private equity-owned businesses, the bank I ran in Austria, Mutuals, Nationwide Building Society, family-owned businesses that I've worked with for the last 10 years, and of course the public sector, both in health and education. And there are so many books written on leadership that it would be wrong of me to try and talk about leadership and add to that. I couldn't. What I can do maybe is just a couple of reflections from me. The first reflection is the one thing that I do see about great leaders is they just surround themselves with great teams. They bring people together, they encourage them, they play to their strengths, and the team is more important than the individual. And if there's one thing that I would encourage every leader to do is to think hard about creating that team, building to their strengths, and delivering great results as a consequence. The second thing I've learned is there's no such thing as an identikit for what a great leader looks like. It's all about you and your leadership signature, what you stand for, your values, your beliefs, the things that are important. And you might tune those to the situation you're in, but authenticity is key. And the best piece of leadership advice I ever got was when somebody, it was a guy called Terry Bowden at Barclays, turned around to me and said, David, you know, you could be all right at this leadership group thing if only you'd be yourself. Don't try and be others. Don't imitate others. Be yourself. And I hold that still to this day. And I think those things of surrounding yourself with big teams, being authentic and really caring for your people are so important as we stand here today in 2020. Because I think we now have the biggest leadership challenge of a generation, maybe even of two or three generations ahead of us. The conflux of a health pandemic and health crisis leading to an economic crisis, as Bruce talked about before, and then potentially into a broader societal crisis, I think is truly an awe-inspiring challenge for all of us. And it's therefore incumbent on us to step up to the plate, which is why the education and training and development that CMI promotes is just so important, because we have to keep learning. So the pandemic is brilliant at finding the weak spots in organizations. It's the great accelerator of change, and it plays into a society where inequality is at its highest ever levels. And therefore, leaders have to give an example and step up to the plate. Now, leaders have to give hope, and I am a believer in the science. I think we will crack this pandemic. Who knows when? We'll have to live with the consequences, however, because the cost is truly enormous. The cost for the economy, the cost for the individuals of their health and their families. And we've learned an enormous amount. So for me, the real challenge for us is how do we ensure that we liberate the great benefits that our teams have got? Because the one thing this pandemic has taught us more than anything is that the impossible has become possible. Whether it's all of us working from home, whether it's the NHS creating the equivalent of 57 new district general hospitals of capacity in less than a month to look after 20,000 really sick people, whether it's the Lloyd's insurance market going from everything on sort of individual conversation to completely transformed into trading and working from home, or whether it's 37,000 people getting mortgage payments agreed within a day as a result of an app that was designed, built, tested, and delivered by Nationwide in 24 hours. The story is give people clarity of objective, create the environment, get great people, give them their head, and wonderful people will move mountains for you and make great change. And that, for me, is what we have to keep going, because the challenges will be around us, and we have multiple opportunities to step up to the plate. Because let's be clear, as leaders, we also have to work within the society we have the privilege to serve. And actually, that's what I would leave as my final message as I think about the leadership challenge for the future, is we have to be authentic to ourselves. But the other thing we see, we have to take the difficult decisions. But what is really clear is that society has a very low tolerance for people trying to profiteer from what is a difficult circumstance, or people who are not acting in the way that is consistent with being fair and responsible to their colleagues and their work and their customers. So let's step up to that plate. Let's show that business can make a massive difference. And let's reflect on one of my leadership heroes, Mahatma Gandhi, when he said in 1919, that's right, we have to be the change we wish to see in the world. And that's what I try and step up every day. I ask myself, how can we and how can I help in a small way make the world slightly better for the people we have the privilege to serve and the privilege to work with? So, Bruce, thank you ever so much indeed. It's a great honour to be here. I really appreciate it.
David, thank you very much indeed, and for your inspirational words, and congratulations.
Thank you.
It's now my pleasure to invite our Lifetime Achievement Award holder onto the stage. The Lifetime Achievement Award for 2019 has been made to Sherry Kutu, CBE. Sherry is a serial entrepreneur and angel investor who has over 30 years' experience in senior leadership roles, serving on the boards of companies, charities, and universities. With more than 60 angel investments, 3 IPOs, and numerous JVs and acquisitions behind her, Sherry has extensive experience in early and mid-stage companies. Sherry is passionate about inspiring STEM and entrepreneurship in young people through Founders for Schools and Better Leadership and Management in fast-growing businesses through Scale Up Institute. Sherry was awarded the CBE in 2013 in the New Year's Honours List for services to entrepreneurship. It's my privilege to welcome Sherry Kutu.
Thank you very much. Your Royal Highness, Lords, Ladies and Gentlemen, Anne and Bruce, thank you for this award. It is incredible to me, particularly when I look back to the past winners, that I wanted to pay particular tribute to Dame Stephanie Shirley, who has been a British information technology pioneer, who so inspired me when I was in my early 20s that when I was mid-35, I named my daughter after her. And that's because I wanted my daughter to be a pioneer, to be brave, to be fearless, to be adaptable, to be pragmatic, and most of all, to be resilient. And I think that these are the hallmarks of our time, and they're the hallmarks of leadership, they're the hallmarks of management. When I first heard about Dame Steve Shirley, I was a one-year master's student at the London School of Economics, and we were asked to study her company and her methods of management, and they were seen to be unusual, and we were studying them, we were studying them 35 years later. And although I didn't meet her in person at that time, I encountered her and I was very inspired by what she had done. She changed the rules of the game. She took idle female talent and allowed them to make incredible contributions to the world. And we've all won from that. She also changed what a CEO looked like. And she's paved the ways for scores of others in all sectors. I later followed her other examples of leadership that hadn't been displayed at that time when I was studying her when I was 20, into other areas where her works in autism, her works in philanthropy, her works in education and in professional development. And you know, what a role model, and what an honor to be able to follow in her footsteps. I'm amazed that I'm here. My journey started in British Columbia, Canada, where my teenage years were spent in a logging town, and I was the first person in my family that went to university. It was my teachers and my neighbors and members of my community that shone a light down a path and said, You could go to university, you know. It's like, no, I don't think I could do that. And they persuaded me that I could. And they also helped persuade my parents that it would be okay for me to go, and they helped me fill out the scholarship applications. And they allowed me to see a path that I had not seen. And I'm very pleased that they did so, because if they hadn't done that, I wouldn't have gone to the LSE, and I wouldn't have met Shirley, and I wouldn't have been inspired by what she's done. Universities and education have been really important to me. but my perception of them has changed a little bit. The LSA raised my aspirations and my capabilities, and it also influenced my first job as a computer programmer, working for a professional services firm. And that led me to work with other people who I also found inspiring. And they allowed me to understand that there were still lots more things that I didn't know, and I wanted to know them. So I went on and I had some further study, formal study, in a conventional university. But it was that third bout of formal study that turned me into a lifelong learner, one where curiosity rules every single day and is absolutely rewarding every single day. And I think that still spurs me on, and it's spurred me on to do many things since then. It also gave me the first opportunity to make very significant forays into the world of volunteering. And the world of volunteering has absolutely fundamentally impacted my life and given me rich rewards way beyond anything I could have imagined. Lifelong friends, a sense of community, understanding what your tribe is. And I couldn't encourage more of us to do more volunteering every day throughout your life, not just after you're retired. But I think it can shape us. And it leads to all sorts of unexpected things that are also good. When my first job, although it was fairly full on, I volunteered in the alumni sort of as an alumni community, and that led to one of the fellow community members investing in my company, which I had never anticipated. It also led to many other things. It probably led to me forming the first platform business. And as you mentioned, Bruce, I've now invested in and grew more than 50 other double-sided platforms. I really do like double-sided platforms. They're really very good for bringing people together. My transition after that from executive into non-executive took quite a lot of learning and quite a lot of adjustment, and thank goodness for peers who also allowed me to make the adaptations that you make as you go through your career from executive to non-executive to portfolio to many other things. That led me to lead to start up other things, but I don't necessarily start up so many for-profit things these days. I'm now setting up not-for-profit things and philanthropic charities. They're still double-sided marketplaces, though. So my latest, you mentioned Founders for Schools, WorkFinder, Digital Boost. These are all double-sided marketplaces that are also learning platforms for both sides of the marketplace, so that we can learn how to mentor and we can also learn how to be mentored. And I find that very exciting. The big companies that I also serve on, I've been hugely honored to work with Pearson, the LSE. I've been amazed at how they have adapted very, very quickly in unusual circumstances to the trials and tribulations that have been posed on us by COVID. And although I might have told myself at an earlier stage that it's only the little companies where people can adapt, that's absolutely not the case. And that's one of the really nice side effects and insights that we have from COVID, that we can rise to this. And it doesn't matter if we work for a really large company or a small company. It's people that are around us, and it's our community that can achieve anything. And I'm excited to know that we can achieve anything, because there's a lot left. There's a lot left to achieve. 2020 has shown us the disruption of technology and the triumph of humanity. Different ways of doing things. I love the fact that in my inbox this morning from McKinsey, there was an article that talked about we had accelerated 7 years in the past 6 months in the adoption of technology. That's a lot of learning, and that's a lot of adaptation. And again, it shows the human spirit. At the same time that we saw that, I'm equally a little bit dismayed in that many of the advances are disproportionately around the larger companies and the medium-sized companies. And I think there's quite a lot of work to do for the 99% of people that work for small companies. And the learning and development that our employers put into every single one of our employees every day is disproportionate. It is that which led me to my latest thing, which is Digital Boost, which we proudly have done with CMI guiding us in our footsteps. It allows all of us to understand what it makes to remotely work and understands what a blended model is. This is my first blended model of a dinner and awards ceremony, and so thank you for leading. But mostly bringing people together and including everybody is more difficult than it was before, and we will all have to adapt to that. We'll have to make sure that everybody's voice is represented, and it's easier to overlook that possibly at the moment. So I think we will have to be brave. I want to make sure in particular that we have the voices of young people around us so that they understand and influence the direction of the world that they will come to inherit from us. Although this is a lifetime achievement award, I very much feel that there is much more work to do. And I hope to do it with the CMI community at my side. I hugely admire this organization and what it stands for and what it has achieved. And I can only spur you on and say there's much work to do, but no better to do it with the community that you love and that you're a part of. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Sherry, thank you so much for sharing your life's journey and some of the insights that you've garnered along the way. Let me be the first to say that I'm sure this isn't a signing off, but just a stepping stone to the next stage of your extremely distinguished career. We're delighted to have you as our Lifetime Achievement Award holder for 2019. Thank you so much indeed.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my final duty of the evening to welcome to the stage Lord Price, the CMI's new president. Mark enjoyed a long and successful career in the retail sector at Waitrose and the John Lewis Partnership. He spent time in government as Minister of State for Trade and is the founder of Engaging Works, which is very aligned with CMI's mission and purpose, as it focuses on creating engaged and happy workforces, who in turn improve the customer's experience and help businesses to thrive. I know that under his leadership, CMI will go from strength to strength. Mark, welcome.
Thank you very much. Your Royal Highness, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. First of all, can I thank Her Royal Highness for her kind words. I'm delighted she's no longer going to hold me responsible for the quality of the produce in Waitrose, and I very much look forward to working with her going forward. Could I also thank Anne, our CEO, and Bruce for their very warm welcome, and could I add my own congratulations to all of tonight's award winners. I'm extremely excited to become the president of the CMI, succeeding Bruce Carnegie Brown. Bruce has been such a positive influence during his time as president, not least providing calm and reassuring leadership of the board through the unprecedented events of the last 6 months. I'd like to personally thank him for all that he has achieved and for the wise counsel that he has given me. We all know that the world of work has been changing at a pace. New technology and environmental concerns are creating a paradigm shift for all organizations and society. There is an ongoing and heightened focus on greater fairness and equality in the workplace, including around gender, age, and ethnicity. Added to which, managers are facing the economic challenges and opportunities presented by COVID-19 and here in the UK, Brexit. All of which places even greater emphasis on more skilled and better management. The CMI was established in the wake of the Second World War with the purpose to raise the quality and the standard of management in the workplace. And that mission has never been more relevant. As our Royal Charter sets out, we are here for the public benefit. It says, "The objects of the Institute shall be to promote for the public benefit the art and science of management in relation to the applied sciences, the arts, the trades and professions, the administration of government and public services, industry and commerce." Better management drives the economy. It increases the tax take, which in turn funds our public services and so improves our society. As Bruce said, I spent 3.5 decades working for the John Lewis Partnership, whose supreme purpose is the happiness of its employees. I believe, and academic research supports the view, that increased employee happiness improves engagement and improves commercial results. It's an approach that's better for employees, better for organisations, and better for society. As research from my Engaging Business and Workle digital platform shows, employees mainly leave organisations because of the poor relationship they have with their line manager. Good management skills have a disproportionate bearing on people's workplace happiness. I'm therefore delighted to be able to join Anne and the team at the CMI in promoting and supporting improved management and leadership. I look forward to meeting as many of you as I can over the next few years. Thank you very much.
Honoured guests, thank you for joining us for CMI's President's Awards 2020. We hope you've enjoyed this evening as much as we've enjoyed hosting you. We wanted to say a big thank you to all of our speakers for joining us this evening, to our award winners for the inspirational example they set for our profession, and to everyone who made this evening possible. If you'd like to learn more about CMI and our work, grab your phone and using your camera, scan the QR code on screen now. Let us know what you thought about tonight's event by joining the conversation online using the hashtag CMI President's Awards. From everyone at CMI, thank you and good night.